Don't bother to look up the definition of booty candy, the outrageous title of Robert O'Hare's wild comedy about growing up black and gay. The most colorful words are nearly always missing from the dictionary, as Sutter, the young protagonist of this rambunctious play, discovers early on. This is from a review that Charles McNulty wrote for the Los Angeles Times. I really like this quote because I think it just captures the entire play in just a couple of sentences, which I thought was really funny. Today, I would like to discuss a couple of themes and then conduct a dialogue about booty candy. My credibility for this speech is that I read the play, I read multiple reviews and a couple of interviews with Robert O'Hara. The themes I would like to discuss today are gender, sexuality, and race. First, I would like to start with gender. From a review that Charles McNulty wrote for the Los Angeles Times in 2015, he says, "Sutter isn't like other boys. His Michael Jackson obsession is largely taken in stride, though his mother doesn't approve of his elaborate moonwalk routine whenever they're out in public." I really like this quote because I think it kind of shows the stereotypes that men are kind of forced into, even at a young age, that they need to not be flamboyant, they need to be a man. There was a couple of examples of this in the show. In the beginning of the show, Sutter says, "Mommy, what's a period?" The young black mom says, "What you put at the end of a sentence. Why?" Sutter, "Because my ink pen burst in my pants the other day, and the boy said that I had my period, and I didn't understand what they meant. But Mommy, I think the period also means something else besides what you put at the end of a sentence." There's a long silence. And then the young black mom responds, "Look it up. That's what I bought you the dictionary for." I really like this quote because you can tell how uncomfortable the mother is from this question that her young son is asking her. And I think it's just interesting how she kind of avoids the topic of this, where had she expanded on it a little more, I think his childhood and how he grew up might have been very different. Later in the play, Sutter is talking to his mother and stepfather. Stepfather says, "You need to stop playing those Whitney Houston albums and stop talking on the phone for 3 hours every night with Brandon about Star Search. And you need to start mowing the lawn twice a week." Middle-aged mother says, "And wash my car." Stepfather says, "And scrub the bathroom with more Comet." Middle-aged mother, "And do the dishes without listening to the Culture Club." These kind of comments go on for about 2 pages of them telling Sutter how he needs to be more of a man. They tell him this after he tells them that he has been followed by a man. But their response is, "What did you do? How did you provoke this?" And I think that's really interesting that they're kind of forcing those gender norms on him, that they're not asking, "How can we help? How can we make this stop?" They're saying, "Well, you weren't being enough of a man. That's probably why this happened. Here's how you can be more of a man." So my discussion question for later is, would Sutter have been forced into a strict gender norm had he been a woman? Why or why not? Now that we've talked about gender, I would like to move on to the topic of sexuality. A review from Charles Isherwood in the New York Times in 2014, he said, "Sutter's early seduction by an older white man has bred him in a burning need for some kind of psychosexual revenge." I like this quote because I think there's multiple times in this show where we see Sutter kind of questioning his identity, his sexuality. He doesn't really know if he identifies as straight, does he identify as gay? He goes back and forth a lot. Early in the play, we meet Reverend Benson, who says, "I want to tell all you choir boys up in here, you ain't got to be afraid of who you are. You ain't got to be afraid of what you do. You ain't got to be afraid how you walk, how you talk, the curl in your hair. You ain't got to be afraid how you twirl, how you whirl, and how you swirl." The scene with Reverend Benson was probably one of my favorites. I just thought it was really fun. And you see that he is no longer afraid of his sexuality. He is coming out and he is proud. And he also wants to make other people feel very comfortable with their sexuality. Towards the end, he even is telling them to stand up with him, stand up and say, acknowledge their sexuality. And I thought that was really cool that he is trying to get them to be more comfortable with who they are. Later in the show, Sutter says to Roy, his brother-in-law, "Sutter, What do you want to do? Roy, I told you I don't. Sutter, say it. Roy, I don't really. Sutter, say it. Roy, I want you to ride my dick. This part of the show was, I think, very interesting because early on we see Sutter being very curious about just a lot of different things, but this is, I think, the first scene where we really see him starting to explore his sexuality, starting to question, you know, question, is he gay, is he straight? He kind of has this moment with Roy, which I thought was really interesting. So my discussion question for later is, do you think people are more comfortable with their sexuality depending on their community? Now that we've talked about sexuality, I'd like to move on to my final point, race. Chris Jones, in the Chicago Tribune in 2017, said, the style of the piece, to say the least, free-ranging, but its unity and worth comes from the clarity of personal truths which morph into macro-truths about race. I really enjoyed this quote because I think there's a lot going on in this show, and it's very easy to get lost. I know I had to go back and reread some scenes just because a lot does get thrown at you at once, but it kind of all comes back to race in the end. And you see a lot of the scenes end up do talking about race and race of the characters. At the end of Act One, the white moderator says, so what are you all working on? Terry O'Malley? By the way, I've often wondered, how exactly did you get the name Terry O'Malley? Seems odd for a black playwright to have the last name O'Malley. How did that come about? Writer One responds, slavery. In the show, then there is a big silence, and I think that shows that the moderator didn't really know what he was asking at the time, and I think it kind of shocked him when Writer One responded, which I thought was just a very powerful moment. In the same scene, Writer Two says, I'm writing a play about women on the phone with some other woman, talking about pussy. The moderator says, what does that have to do with race? Writer Two, what does pussy have to do with race? Moderator, what do women on the phone talking about pussy have to do with race? Writer Two, why does it have to have anything to do with race? Moderator, you're a black playwright. This was also a very powerful moment, at least for me in this show, because I think that this moderator is completely clueless. He shows multiple times that he brings up race a lot to all of these playwrights. And I think it's just really interesting how he kind of feels that if you are a playwright of color, you have to always incorporate your race in your shows that you write, which is not true. And so I just thought it was really interesting that he somehow always brings it up to these playwrights. So my discussion question for later is, how does race affect the characters? So now that I've talked about all my three themes, I'm already sitting. I would like to invite you all to partake in a little discussion. All right. So my first question is, would Sutter have been forced into a strict gender norm had he been a woman? Why or why not?